So it's my pleasure to introduce Matthew Brown. He's currently a research associate in the psychiatry department at the University of Alberta. So he's going to be talking about a topic that I really like, which is computational psychiatry, looking at clinical applications of machine learning and applying it to some decently sized data sets, upwards of 50 to 1,000 subjects. And very much looking forward to your talk, and thanks for coming.
Great. Thank you. Thanks for listening to me. Now that sets the bar. Now I can't give a crap to talk. I just want to calibrate this. So who is from neuroscience or psychology? That sort of background. Just put a hex. Some. Who's computational engineering, physics, this kind of thing? Okay, mixture. All right. This is casual. If I say something you don't understand or you want more clarification, just shout at me to clarify it. And I'll try to kind of give an overview, make this so that there's something for everybody in here. So I'm from Alberta. That's in Edmonton, Canada. So that's here. It's dry like here, but colder. A bit of setting the stage. So psychiatry and the modern conception of psychiatry includes addiction as a mental health disorder. It is an expensive and devastating set of diseases. So in Canada, the estimate is that it costs $51 billion a year. Here in the US, the estimate is $750 billion a year. That's in direct and indirect costs. So psychiatric illnesses cause things like homelessness and suicide and crime. So all these other things besides direct health service are affected by psychiatry. And in fact, it's the largest cause of disability and the most expensive disease category in the developed world, according to the World Health Organization. So the first time I heard that, I was surprised. So this is more expensive than heart disease, and it's more expensive than cancer as a set of diseases. And there are some challenges. Diagnosis and prognosis can be difficult. I'll get into that a little bit. And the treatment efficacy is variable. So in some cases, treatment is successful, but in many cases, it's not. So there's a problem here, and I think machine learning can help. I want to talk briefly about biomarkers in psychiatry. And because I'm going to be talking about imaging, I'm going to also use this opportunity to just show some images. So that's a structural MRI. I think a lot of you people work with this sorts of data, so you know what that is. And that's a healthy person's structural MRI. On the right, we have a structural MRI from a Huntington's patient. And it's pretty obvious if you know what to look for. The ventricles are enlarged because the caudate nucleus has degenerated. So that's a biomarker for Huntington's, that MR image pattern. That's a pretty clear biomarker. And if you're a neurologist looking into Huntington's, that's what you'd be looking for. A couple other examples. On the left, we have an effusion-weighted image from a stroke patient. So again, that's pretty obvious, the big white feature there on the bottom right. Those are lesions from something called neurocysticercosis on the right. That is it's actually a gut parasite that is encysted in the brain ectopically. So that's kind of a nasty thing. Anyway, the point is that you can look at these images and you can see something that is diagnostically useful. So those are biomarkers based on MRI. And they're used extensively in neurology. We don't have anything like that in psychiatry. So there are no really clear biomarkers from structural imaging or from any other biological source in psychiatry. Not yet, anyway. Instead, psychiatric diagnosis and prognosis is based on structured interview as guided by the DSM-4 or 5 now, or ICD-10. So DSM is Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, even though the manual doesn't really have much statistics in it, to be honest. A few issues with these things is that these structured interviews are somewhat subjective, and you often have poor inter-rater reliability. So for example, major depression, which is one of the most common psychiatric diseases, has very poor inter-rater reliability based on the DSM-5 criteria. So these are some issues. Because in the absence of biomarkers, people do the best they can. I mean, these are serious diseases, and we have to do something about them. We can't just wash our hands of it. So in the absence of biomarkers, the DSM-5 and the ICD-10, these things are defined essentially by committee rather than biology. I mean, it's informed by what we know of the biology, but it's not clearly defined by the biology. And even there's this issue, do we have the correct definitions for the diseases? Is the ontology that we use in psychiatry, is that even correct? And this is debated, right? And then the final thing, recently there's a trend towards using the pharmacotherapy, using the drugs off-label. So you know, instead of using something like an antipsychotic, you might, to treat just psychosis, you might use that to treat something else. So if we're doing that anyway, do we care about the label? Do we care about which box we put somebody into if we're just going to treat them with whatever we think is going to work anyway? Maybe we don't want to be taking that approach. So just some food for thought, just sort of raising some things that are some controversies that are rumbling around in the background. And this, of course, this whole issue brings up, well, this was the motivation for the National Institutes of Mental Health's research domain criteria, which if you work in psychiatry, you've heard of this. And it's essentially a call to base psychiatry in the biology. And so I've said all this, there's been a lot of attempts to do this, right? It's not like the research community is sitting idly by. There's been a lot of attempts. Most of it is group comparisons, comparing patients to controls or different patient groups. And those could have led to biomarkers in principle, but they have not. Just empirically, they have not. Which brings me to this. I want to talk about some differences between group and individual differences analyses. And I'm going to just introduce a couple other things. Well, to set the stage, we saw structural images on the left. Again, this is, a lot of you know this already, but just to make sure everyone's on the same page. On the left, we have a structural image. So that's a static picture of the brain that does not change. On the right, we have a functional image. So this is a bold functional image. And you can see that it's blurry. Why would we put up with such a blurry, low resolution image? By trading off resolution, we're getting a dynamic activation time course, which I'm showing on the left there. So this just means that instead of a static image, we're getting a picture of dynamic brain activity as it changes over time. And again, I know that's review for a lot of you. And you can do things, you can analyze this. This is functional connectivity analysis, where we analyzed some resting state data and you come up with some description of what the networks are doing. And if you do that with ADHD patients, so this is with the ADHD 200 data set, which you might have heard of. If you do that with a bunch of ADHD patients and a bunch of healthy controls, a typical thing to do would be to compare those groups, patients versus controls. And if you compare the involvement of different brain regions in this network, and incidentally that's the default mode network, if that means something to you. If it doesn't, it doesn't matter for the example. All you need to know is we're comparing some brain activity patterns between patients and controls, and we're getting some region of statistical difference. Okay, so in this case, patients because it's blue, patients are showing less involvement in posterior cingulate cortex. So the question is that a biomarker? Can we use that pattern on the right there, this statistical group difference, can we use that to do something really basic like differentiate ADHD from healthy controls? And it turns out that we cannot, because the underlying data has a lot of overlap. So on the left, we have take that region on the right there, we just compute the average weighting in this network, and we do that for all of our subjects. And the patients are in red and the controls are in blue. And you can see that there's a whole lot of overlap. So if I give you a new subject's weighting value, you know, if it's this, if it's 0.5, that doesn't really help you very much in distinguishing whether that subject is a patient or a control because of this heavy overlap. Now, I told you originally that there is still a significant difference at the group level. So that's what I want to point out. Again, this is probably review for some of you. You can have significant differences between groups even when there is substantial overlap amongst the distributions of those two groups. And the reason why is that these group comparisons, they look at the mean, right? They look at group means, and they really only care about how precisely you can define that group mean, how good your estimate of the mean is. They don't actually care about overlap directly. So you can have a large sample, you can have a well-defined You can have well-defined group means, and they can be significantly different even in the presence of this overlap. And this sort of thing, I believe, is the real problem that research in psychiatry has encountered in trying to define psychiatric biomarkers. They've basically been running into this where you find group differences, but those differences do not translate into biomarkers. And that's just what this slide says. So, obviously, next step. Machine learning can help here because it looks at individual differences, not just group differences. I think a lot of you know what machine learning is, so just really briefly, it used to be called artificial intelligence. In the 80s, there was a big boom in artificial intelligence. It was going to solve everything. It was going to solve all the health problems, stock market, economic cyclicity, everything. So massive investments happened in artificial intelligence, and then there was a crash. And suddenly, all the people who did research in artificial intelligence could not fund their research anymore. So then they all started doing machine learning, which was the exact same thing, just called something different. A couple highlights about what machine learning is. In case you're not familiar, basically it looks at patterns in the data, including patterns that humans cannot pick up on with visual inspection or traditional analysis. It emphasizes individual differences, not just group differences. And I'm sure you know this already, it's used everywhere. Stock trading is basically people don't really do stock trading anymore. Machine learning algorithms do it for us. Mail routing, it reads the mail and tells it where to go. Fraud detection, credit card fraud detection, and so on and so forth. All these things are all machine learning. One really quick example, to do machine learning, you describe objects with features. So I've shown two features here. So we have motorcycles, and we have cars, and we have mass and gas usage. And you get, each individual object has a mass, it has a gas usage, and we can plot all of those feature values in this two-dimensional space. And we can start to do some machine learning where it tries to differentiate motorcycles and cars. And this just shows a decision boundary separating the two. You can see that some of the cars are really separate, some of the motorcycles are really separate. There's this boundary region where you get a bit of mix-up, where you get some errors happening. So I went through that real quick because I think you guys know that already. Is that clear? If you don't know that, you're going to have trouble with the rest. So speak now or forever stay confused. All right, just one more example of a two-dimensional feature space with some red and blue objects and a couple different decision boundaries. Different machine learning algorithms create different decision boundaries in the feature space. Another example of machine learning is not limited just to classification, where we differentiate objects. It can do data-driven analysis, where it tries to find some description of the data space, in this case, using clustering. Okay. And I showed a couple two-dimensional examples. When you're dealing with large data sets like fMRI or imaging data that can have hundreds of thousands or millions or tens of millions of data points per subject, you usually do some kind of feature selection or feature extraction. So in this case, I'm just trying to illustrate going from the fMRI data to selecting some predefined clusters and defining the cross-correlation amongst those things. So you might go from a 10 million dimensional raw data to 600 or 700 dimensional cross-correlation matrix, this kind of thing. Again, I think that's probably pretty familiar to this crowd. I give this kind of a talk to doctors a lot, medical doctors, so I have to explain that you can combine data from different sources. With the computer, it's all data, right? It's okay if it comes from genetics or imaging or whatever. And I also have to point out that even though these two-dimensional examples kind of seem trivial, I mean, who cares, right? We can just see the class boundary. Well, once you go to 1,000 dimensions or 10,000 dimensions, you can't do that anymore, and that's where the machine learning comes into its own. Okay, questions so far? I assume everyone's comfortable with that. In clinical decision-making, two of the most important problems are diagnosis and prognosis. So diagnosis, can we define a disease? Can we assign a disease category to a patient? So can we differentiate among diseases? That's important. Prognosis, what will happen to the patient? Will they get better? Do they need treatment? How will they respond to different treatments? We can frame these as machine learning classification problems. So diagnosis, what I call simple diagnosis, can we differentiate a disease category from healthy controls? That's not really clinically useful, but it's important for research to have a starting place, and that's sort of an easy starting place. Can we, if we've got a bunch of patients with a disease, can we differentiate them from healthy controls? Differential diagnosis, which is clinically relevant, differentiates among disease categories. Prognosis, given a treatment X, will that patient improve or not? That's a yes-no binary classification problem. And the point of doing all this, if we do machine learning analysis, ultimately we can come up with complex biomarkers. So the fitted machine learning model comprises a biomarker. Not necessarily an interpretable biomarker, and that's an issue, right? But it is a biomarker of some kind. A couple examples of doing this in practice. So this is one of the earlier papers diagnosing schizophrenia? Comparing schizophrenia to healthy controls with structural MRI. It's a little hard to see. I hope you can see these little colored blobs. Those are the regions that a support vector machine selected as being diagnostic for schizophrenia. And in this case, they got 86% accuracy, which is not bad for a kind of a proof of concept thing. One thing to point out, I don't think any human designing a diagnostic algorithm would come up with something like this. These particular, pattern of regions scattered all over the brain. That's where an example of machine learning doing something that a human would have difficulty in doing directly. One more example, in this case, depression. This is with an emotional face fMRI task. And again, comparing a disease category, in this case depression, to healthy controls. And they got pretty good accuracy, 86%. And on the left, we see the brain regions that, again, it's a support vector machine. It chose those regions as being diagnostically useful. And they're scattered all over the brain. Same point as last slide. A human trying to design a diagnostic algorithm by hand would not come up with that. Okay? So any questions on that? Again, I kind of went through that kind of quick, but I think you guys are tracking. A couple things, our group, we work on Alzheimer's, schizophrenia, depression, autism, ADHD, and we use structural MRI, fMRI, DTI. I'll come back to that next line about the 2011 ADHD 200 competition. And as of last year at least, we had the best results that we know of so far published with two large data sets, and I'm going to come back to that. And we're also starting work on neurocystic sarcosis, which is that, I showed you a slide of that earlier. That's a disease we do not have in the developed world, but is endemic in the developing world, where they don't have good water all the time. And they get those parasites from the water, causing that disease. This is just sort of a summary of what's been done in simple diagnosis, which, to remind you, that's comparing disease versus healthy controls. And most of the research in this area has been focused on this problem of simple diagnosis. And that's a good place to start because it's the easiest thing to do. It's not yet it's not yet clinically useful, but it's a good place to start. So just a kind of a brief summary. Lots of different disease categories, depression, schizophrenia, ADHD, autism, lots of other ones that I haven't listed there. Most of the studies use small samples, 20 to 30 subjects. And you get accuracies all over the place, from chance accuracy, 50% accuracy. I'll just point that out again. I think this is probably not new to this group, but you want to beat chance accuracy. If you've got 50% patients, 50% controls, if I flip a coin, I'm getting 50% accuracy. So you want to do better than chance, obviously. So a number of studies, they're getting accuracies anywhere from chance up to 90% plus. So there's a lot of variability in the results. There are fewer studies with large samples. And I'm calling a large sample 500 or more subjects. That's just arbitrary, right? And the reason is simple. Large data sets are harder to acquire, so there are fewer studies. The accuracy values, again, there's some variability, 50 to 70%. As far as I know, no really large samples in psychiatry have achieved accuracy better than 70%. at least no studies that do it properly. I'll get into this a little bit. There are studies that make a cheat, and they report better accuracy, but that doesn't count. And I'm going to argue that large data sets are ultimately going to be important for clinical applicability to deal with this variability issue. And that Oru et al. 2012 review is nice if you want to look at this stuff. So here we are. I want to talk about some pitfalls and caveats of doing this. This is cute. We had a summer student looking at some psychosis data. And the summer student did something really simple. He just did Fourier analysis. And then he looked at the power spectrum. And he found some voxels that were highly diagnostic of psychosis compared to controls. And those voxels were in the eye. And this actually makes sense in retrospect. So in psychosis, you have eye movement disturbances, right? They move their eyes differently compared to healthy people. And in the scanner, this is fMRI data, in case that wasn't clear. In the scanner, eye movements can interact with the scanning sequence, so you can actually see eye movement patterns or some kind of a signal that is caused by eye movements in the scanner. And that's what this was. So that's interesting. Basically, an expensive way to acquire eye movement data from psychosis subjects. And I'm pointing that out just to sort of introduce this idea. What are we actually detecting when we apply machine learning to imaging? Well, sometimes it's surprising what we're detecting. Another example of that. This is a study we did with depression. In this case, we're comparing 19 patients with major depression against 19 controls. And this is with resting state fMRI. And if you use a strict mask that excludes any voxels outside the brain, we got 58% accuracy, which is not very good. In fact, it's not statistically different from chance. Okay. We also tried using a more liberal mask, a mask that included some voxels outside the brain, and that actually increased the accuracy by 5%. And that made the difference in this case between statistical significance with chance, right? So this was actually significantly different from chance. Again, it's not fantastic. 63% accuracy is not that great. But the point is, and this didn't come up very well, but hopefully you can see that, these are all the voxels that, in this case, it was an independent components analysis followed by support vector machine. This is what the diagnostic, or that the machine learning algorithm chose as diagnostic. Lots of voxels outside the brain. So what is that? We don't really know. One obvious thing would be motion artifact. If you work with fMRI data, you know that motion artifact is the bane of fMRI research. We tried using the motion parameters from the pre-processing, and it was not significantly different. So I don't actually have a good explanation of why it's using voxels outside the brain, but they seem to be diagnostic, or at least providing some diagnostic utility in this case. So again, just kind of stirring the pot. My opinion of the state of the field right now is that a lot of the results are inconsistent. You get some studies that are showing chance accuracy, some studies that are showing very good accuracy, 80 or 90% plus, again with this simple diagnosis problem. And to give one example of that, this is that depression study. The analysis I showed on the last slide was a subset of it, but our full sample was 56 patients, 19 controls. We had task-based fMRI and we got chance accuracy, so that completely fails to replicate previous results where a very similar design showed 86% accuracy, and that's this Fodal paper from 2008. With resting state fMRI, we had some success with the most severe group of patients, 68% accuracy. With the less severe patients, we were getting chance accuracy. So what does that mean? Well, I mean, it's disappointing to see such sort of disparate results, right? I think one thing is small samples, and I'll come back to that in a second. But before I get to that, I want to talk about this issue of how do you choose your patients? On one extreme, you can choose a very sort of hand-picked, extreme set of patients, right? You can hand-select your patients to be clearly, these are severe, depression patients, and we're going to compare them to controls. And that is good from a research point of view, where you get a clear separation of signals. But from a clinical point of view, that's not so useful. If you hand that off to a clinician, they'll say, okay, that's nice that you found these differences with these hand-picked groups, but the patients coming into my clinic are very heterogeneous. So that's what we were trying to do here. With these 56 patients, they spread the whole range from mild to severe. And that creates issues, obviously. This slide first. I also mentioned the small sample issue. So I think there's a file drawer effect happening, or a small an effect size bias. If you have 10 different groups trying something with a small sample, you know, 20 patients and 20 controls, 10 patients and 10 controls, and a lot of the early studies only had 10 patients, then because of publication bias, because it's easier to publish positive results, you're going to see more of those. And then occasionally you see a negative result published. So I think there's an issue with that, small samples. You guys did this MLSP schizophrenia Kegel competition. And one of the conclusions was that there was some disparity between the results on the private and public test sets that were used to test accuracy for all of the submissions. And I think, again, that's a symptom of smallish samples. So why don't we use humongous sample sizes? Why don't we go to something like a population research type, 10,000 subjects? And it's expensive, right? It's difficult to recruit patients, and it's expensive to scan them. And we're well aware of this. We have an alcohol addiction study where we wanted to recruit 70 patients with alcohol addiction. And we wanted to compare a set of 35 patients with one with a naltrexone pharmacotherapy versus a control set without. We screened 1,200 patients, and we only recruited 25 of them to the study due to some safety things and due to various other things. But the point of that is these clinical studies can be difficult. So assembling big data sets is hard. One other thing I want to point out, I think this is getting better. And from talking to people at this group, you guys are aware of this, which is excellent. But the issue of overfitting and multi-comparisons is not always properly addressed. So do you guys know what overfitting is? Basically, because these machine learning algorithms are powerful, they can latch onto noise in the data, which then does not generalize to new samples. And this can show up in a lot of insidious ways. So the standard cross-validation when you're training a machine learning algorithm does not always protect you if you're not careful. And I've seen studies that will do something like test 10 different machine learning algorithms on the same data, even though they're using five-fold cross-validation for each of the algorithms separately. They are testing 10 different algorithms, and then they're saying, hey, look, the best algorithm gets 90%. Well, but you tested 10 of them, right? The worst one gets chance. So what they're failing to do there is have a holdout set where you take your best algorithm and then test it on a holdout set and see if it still does well. To summarize that, anything that uses the labels has to be protected by cross-validation. So if you do some sort of feature selection where you do a statistical comparison and you select significant voxels that are significant when you compare patients and controls, that cannot use any of the test set subjects. Otherwise, you're overfitting. If you, the choice of machine learning algorithm, the choice of regularization parameter, the choice of feature extraction algorithm, all of these things have to be done independently of the labels, right? And if you've got a big data set, that's easy. You just, you know, if you've got 1,000 subjects, you pull 200 of them out and you don't use them for your training or feature selection or algorithm selection. If you have a smaller sample, which is more typically the case, you have to do tricky nested cross-validation. And it usually takes me half an hour to explain this. I'm going to explain it in 10 seconds. If you're interested in this, come talk to me after. But what you have to do is, if you got five-fold cross-validation, you hold out one fold for testing. You hold out another validation fold, train on the three, you test on the validation fold, you keep doing that. You choose the best algorithm and best regularization parameter based on the validation set, and you only apply the single best algorithm to the holdout set. Okay? I know I went over that really fast. But again, I've talked to people in your group, and it sounds like you guys know this. This is something that I come across with new students that this takes some time to explain. I've reviewed lots of papers that get this wrong, and I tell them it's wrong. But the reason why I'm kind of belaboring this is a lot of these papers are not reviewed by computational people. So medical doctors don't appreciate these issues, and I actually think that some of the published research is doing this wrong, and they've got artificially inflated results. One last cute story on this issue, and then I'll move on to something else. I was talking to a colleague, and this is a bit of a rumor, but I believe it. She was talking to one of her colleagues, who's a medical doctor, about doing this kind of research, this machine learning medical diagnosis research. And she wanted to make sure that this medical doctor understood about cross-validation. And he said, yeah, we do tenfold cross-validation. It's very simple. You know, you hold out a tenth of the data, and then you train and test. And then you choose the best fold to report. So this guy is doing tenfold cross-validation, and then they're looking at the accuracy results on each of the 10 folds, and they're only reporting the best fold, which is obviously wrong. So again, it's important if you're talking to clinical colleagues to make sure they know about these things. And this brings me to some larger data sets. I've been belaboring this issue of small data sets. Very generously, some groups have made available these large data sets. Essentially, they pooled data over multiple sites. Dealing with all the ethics concerns and all the data sharing would have been a Herculean task. So it's quite impressive that they did this. Some numbers. Two large data sets, the ADHD 200 with ADHD subjects, a BIDE data set with autism. They have over 1,000 subjects in each of these. And structural MRI, they have resting state fMRI. Various papers have tried this simple diagnosis problem, differentiating patients and controls. And I've seen results ranging from 50% of chance accuracy up to 70%. I did not attend OHBM, so maybe I'm out of date. Hopefully I'm not saying the wrong thing. But to my knowledge, these large things, large data set studies have not reported accuracies higher than 70%. There were a couple that reported higher accuracies, but they did things like arbitrarily choose one site. If I see a study and it says, we took the ADHD 200 data set, and we only use data from one of the eight sites, and we got this high accuracy. My next question is, why did you choose that one site? And in some cases, they don't tell you why. And what I think, or what I worry about, is that they tried it on all of the sites, and that one site did really well, so they published that result. Again, if you're reading the literature, or if you're doing these sorts of studies, you need to report why you're using the data that you're using. Okay? To avoid this issue of cherry-picking data that works well. I will mention this other data set, the ADNI Alzheimer's data set. That is a neurology data set, not psychiatry. That is in Alzheimer's, and they've reported, some papers report 95% accuracy, distinguishing Alzheimer's from controls. I'm actually not surprised by that, because if you look at the structural images, you can see the degeneration that happens in Alzheimer's. It's an easier problem. But to my knowledge, nothing in psychiatry. And I'm calling autism, that's kind of neurology, psychiatry. In my opinion, it's kind of on the board between the two. I haven't seen anything with large data sets larger than 70%. I want to, again, this might be old news, but I like telling this story because it's cute. The ADHD 200 competition in 2011 was the first example of a large data set with fMRI and a patient group and controls being made publicly available. And they had this competition where you could you had to train an algorithm, and they gave you a bunch of training data, 776 patients or subjects. And then they had a holdout set of 197 subjects where they gave you the data but not the labels. You had to predict the labels and then they rank you. So it's a competition. And you compete for glory and bragging rights. We submitted the best performing algorithm, but we did not win. The reason we did not win is because we did not use any imaging data. And that's what I'm showing on the bottom here. So these are accuracies of binary diagnosis, patients versus controls. This red line is what we got using a very simple control test with personal characteristic data only. So age, gender, handedness, IQ, and the site where they were scanned at. And that got 75% accuracy on our own tenfold cross-validation. Okay? And these are all of our attempts using cluster, handpicked clusters, principal components, fast Fourier transform, analysis of low frequency fluctuations, a whole bunch of different things. We were just throwing things at the wall. And nothing stuck, right? Like nothing really came anywhere close to this really simple personal characteristic thing. And the deadline for submission came. We asked them, could we submit more than one thing? And they said, no, just one, send us your best. So we sent them the best, which was that algorithm that did not use any imaging. And we got an email half an hour later saying, it sounds like you didn't use any imaging. Yes. And they go, oh, because you beat out all the imaging algorithms. And this is a little bit embarrassing, right? I mean, this is a big, expensive data set, the first data set like this. So I don't really have too much hard feelings for them giving the prize to the best performing imaging algorithm, but we actually submitted the best performing algorithm. Anyway, just an example of trying to dig into the data and figure out what's really going on. I will point out that in terms of generalizing this to the wider issue of applying machine learning to diagnosis, this is not really the best example. ADHD is a controversial diagnosis. And these the clinical sites where these participants were recruited from, they're actually pretty different. Some of them are in North America, some are in Europe, some are in China. I mean, there's a joke that the average New Yorker has ADHD according to Chinese criteria, right? So there's an issue of, do we have the correct ground truth labels? Maybe we don't. Maybe we're not trying to reproduce the same thing, but they're correct thing. Anyway, moving on. We can now do better by combining imaging with the personal characteristic data. We can beat the previous results. And I want to just point out this thing. This is histogram of oriented gradient feature extraction. So this is a texture-based method. Unlike all the other stuff I've shown you, and unlike most of the stuff that we've done before using fMRI and whatever functional connectivity analysis, whatever, this is just a basic texture feature extraction. It's pretty simple. You just look at cells, kind of bins, and you look at the gradient magnitude along different directions, and you just build a histogram of those gradients. That's all you do. And you do that for cell locations in different parts of the brain. So that red box, that's illustrating one cell. You just do that over the brain. And if you do a bit of feature selection, we used MRMR. It doesn't matter what that is if you don't know. It's just a thing that strips out some features, and you apply support vector machine. If you do this, you get pretty good results, actually, with both the ADHD200 and the Abide data set. So for the ADHD200, if you only use personal characteristic data, we're getting 69%. Brief aside, you'll notice a couple slides ago I said 63% accuracy for personal characteristic data. The reason for the discrepancy is that the holdout set is slightly different. There's 22 or 23 subjects we cannot use from the original ADHD200 holdout set because those data are not made public. So we're using only a part of the holdout set, hence this small difference. If you combine personal characteristic and structural MRI, you do slightly better, 70%. Personal characteristic and fMRI, you actually do worse. So the fMRI is making it do worse than personal characteristic data, perversely. And sort of a similar story with the Abide data set. In this case, fMRI and structural MRI do similarly well with 64%. So this is just to point out, kind of my own approach to this. I've been focused on fMRI analysis stuff, but this pretty simple texture thing seems to do pretty well. Why does it do well? Well, we thought that it might be, again, motion related, might be some kind of artifact, right? Maybe patients move differently in the scanner. Again, we tried using the motion correction parameters, and they don't work. So it's not motion. So we don't really know what it is exactly. But these texture things seem to work. And this paper, it's been a bit of a bear to get this published. PLOS One sat on it for a year before sending the reviews back to us. When we submitted it, this was a state-of-the-art result, so the best published on those data sets at that time. It may not still be the best result, because it's been a year and a bit, but whatever. One last thing I want to point out as far as caveats go, this is again with the ADHD 200 data set. One of our students did a PCA analysis on this, and this is after all of the usual normalization things that you do in pre-processing. So this is motion correction, spatial normalization, the intensity normalization, all the, you know, dumb normal things that you do. And after all that normalization, we're still getting this PCA pattern where the different sites are separated in principal component space. So all we did is we projected those subjects onto the first two principal components, and the different colors show the different sites that they came from. In other words, there is substantial inter-site variability remaining in the data after all the usual normalization things that you would do, okay? And we think this might be related to things like signal-to-noise ratio and the interaction of susceptibility with the signal. And that varies on a coil-by-coil, scanner-by-scanner basis, so maybe that's what it is, and we're looking into that, actually. So I can't really tell you any more about that. I'm just pointing out that this thing exists, that you still have this big inter-site variability, even after you do the normal preprocessing. And this is an issue for trying to build a robust classifier that can take data from multiple sites. Obviously, for clinical applications, this will be important, right? I mean, an algorithm needs to be tolerant of inter-site variability.
Did this do any covariation by site prior? Is this leaving? Is this just ignoring site variability altogether?
It's not covarying out the site at all. Okay. Yeah, no, it's just a straight up PCA. So you could do one of these things where you try to, like, you know, regress out or whatever.
Yeah, because all the standard calibration stuff that people typically do one of these things closer together still has variability.
Yeah, should talk more about it after. Yeah, absolutely. Okay, any other questions? Okay, just the home stretch here. I want to talk a little bit about going from where we are now to clinical tools, which, I mean, for me, that's half of the reason. You know, half of the reason is that this is cool. It's fun to work with this stuff. But the other half is that we want to help people. So moving into actual clinical relevance, this simple diagnosis is not clinically relevant, right? Psychiatrists, they can already differentiate these subjects. In fact, if I put, if I put 20 people in a room, 10 with schizophrenia and 10 with 10 who are healthy, you could almost diagnose them by looking at their behavior. If you look at the fingers of someone with psychosis, they're usually nicotine stained because almost everyone with psychosis smokes. There's a joke in psychiatry that is almost a biomarker for psychosis, nicotine stained fingers. But in the clinic, there are problems like differentiating bipolar disorder from major depression. This is very common. If somebody shows up with a depressive episode, 90% of the time they'll end up having major depression. 10% of the time they will end up having bipolar disorder. And the only way to diagnose bipolar disorder now is to wait for that person to express a manic episode. Unfortunately, the treatment for bipolar and depression are very different. So for bipolar, you do a mood stabilizer. For depression, you do an antidepressant. However, giving an antidepressant to a patient with bipolar disorder can promote mania. And mania is potentially dangerous, so you don't want to be doing this. This is not the optimal thing to do, to wait for some poor guy to have a manic episode possibly brought on by the antidepressant. It would be better to scan them on intake and predict which one they have. And there is some work along this, and some of you guys are doing this as well. As far as I know, the work is always smallish samples, right? So this one study, Nordegaard et al., had a very small sample, 10 subjects in each group, and they got impressive accuracy, but again, small sample. This other study was a slightly larger sample, reported chance accuracy. So we're at the early stages with this stuff. Another example, schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. Again, a disease that you want to be able to differentiate. Two disease categories you want to differentiate. And there are some early encouraging successes with smallish samples. One thing that I've sort of mentioned a little bit, there's this issue of the ground truth labels. So we're always trying to reproduce psychiatrist diagnosis, but I mentioned at the beginning that both the diagnostic ontology, the set of disease categories, is defined by committee. So it might not be right, right? And that's the whole RDoC research committee criteria thing, is to have new categories. Just reminding you of that. A couple other useful things. Clinically, prognosis would be useful. So there is a lot of interpatient variability in response to treatment, right? What works for one person does not work for the next. And this can be really frustrating because these if you're talking about pharmacotherapy, all the drugs have side effects. They all require, most of them require gene expression changes to become therapeutic. So it takes them 3 or 4 weeks to become therapeutic. The side effects happen right away. So you're telling somebody, you know, who has schizophrenia or who has depression, someone who's in a compromised state mentally, that they should take this drug that'll make them feel bad, it'll make them gain weight, or whatever it's going to do, and it might work or it might not. We just have to wait for 4 weeks and see, right? This is not the best way to be doing this. If we could predict which treatment would be the best for a given patient, this would have huge clinical value. There are a few studies that are reporting some success with this. Again, there's variability. Some of the studies are reporting 90% accuracy, but again, it's in small samples. So again, encouraging early results, but we need more. And incidentally, these more clinically relevant problems are always harder, right? It's harder to differentiate disease categories than it is to differentiate disease versus healthy control. One last thing, I'm almost done. I want to point out this one study. It's a cool study. This is with the Imogen data set, which is collected mostly in Europe, of adolescents looking at risk behaviors, things like drinking. And they have a really rich data set that includes fMRI, MRI, clinical workup, psychometric stuff, questionnaires, personality stuff, clinical history. They have a huge battery of data. And they have a large sample, almost 700 subjects. And they reported 91% accuracy discriminating binge drinkers from non-binge drinkers. Okay. So this is, again, this is a clinically relevant, or it's working towards clinical relevance. And the interesting conclusion from this is that higher accuracy required using lots of different data sources. On the left, we have, this is actually a prediction of future binge drinking, which was a little bit worse than simply differentiating binge and non-binge drinkers at the initial data collection. It did a little bit worse, but they still did pretty well. And this is using individual feature sources. So that's MRI, that's personality tests, that's cognitive testing, clinical history, and so on. So each of these things in isolation provided some diagnostic utility. When you combine them all together, they got a lot better. And this is showing the accuracy when you hold out one data source. So the point was that no single data source was really conclusive on its own, and that they need to combine lots of data sources, which so far is not something that's done in most of the imaging machine learning research. Usually they're just, usually people look at MRI or fMRI, maybe they combine fMRI and MRI, maybe they add personal characteristics. But for the most part, people are not collecting and using these really diverse data sets. So some concluding things about where to go, working towards clinical tools, will require working on these clinical problems like differential diagnosis and prognosis. And we want to transition out of, so we've had this initial phase of proof of concept stuff with simple diagnosis, comparing patients and controls. That's good. I think it's time to move into other things, into these clinical problems. Large data sets are going to be crucial, which is a current limitation, and this issue of multimodalities is going to be, I think, a promising thing to be looking at. I didn't talk about this too much, this issue of human interpretable models. I'll just mention it there. As you know, a lot of these machine learning models are not very interpretable. So that's another issue which I don't have time to discuss right now. This is my dream project. Collect a whole bunch of patients at intake regardless of diagnosis, in fact, before diagnosis, collect MRI and clinical workup and diverse data, and follow them up, see what worked in terms of pharmacotherapy or cognitive behavioral therapy or whatever. Generate new ontologies. So don't just do a classification thing, but do some kind of clustering and try to come up with new categories. And this is moving into the realm of big science that's expensive. We were on a grant application for $30 million to do this. And we got all the way to the end, and we did not get the money. So this is this, in Canada, there's a program called the Network of Centers of Excellence. So it's the idea is to establish multiple centers of excellence and network them together. So this would have been this study, but we didn't get there. So now we gotta try again and get the money. And I'm bringing this up just to point out the importance of consortia, of inter-institution collaborations. That's really going to be the only way to get the kind of data set sizes that I think we're going to need for clinical deployability. Just a couple of acknowledgments. I work with lots of people who are listed there, and we have funding from all kinds of places which are listed there. And I'll take any questions, so thanks for your attention. This is exactly the thing. So I think that most of the research studies, especially the small sample ones, have chosen the research optimal end of that spectrum. So they're, like you say, they're choosing a select group of patients, and it's a small sample. But in the clinic, clinicians look at these things and they say, that's nice, but I cannot use that. I cannot apply something that is done in this narrow group. I can't do anything with that in the clinic because my patients are diverse. And I think really the only way is just to take the bull by the horns and collect big samples of diverse patients and deal with the mess. I think it's an area that has there's lots of issues we need to come up with, that we need to address. And in my gut feel, again, this is just an opinion, right? I think that the current system of psychiatric classification doesn't deal with this in the right way. I think this is where having big studies with lots of data and coming up with new ontologies that directly relate to treatment outcomes, I think that's what we want to do. I think going through this intermediary where we assign a diagnostic label where the diagnostic system is decided by committee, I don't think that's the best way to go. Again, I'm not a psychiatrist, I'm a research scientist. This is my opinion. So we need these big data sets to really test that. And it's expensive.
Stunned silence.
Yeah. Either everyone understood and they're completely satisfied, or no one understood.
Here we go. I have a question. Has anyone looked into getting data that's already available for medical purposes, like scans that are already taken? Is this a big hurdle? Is this something that might be achievable? Take an MRI on patients who
That's an excellent question. So I worked on another project called the Brain Tumor Analysis Project that did just that. So in brain tumors, obviously MRI scans are part of standard clinical practice. And the reason that worked is because we had a hero radiological oncologist who went to battle for us and dealt with all of the immense bureaucracy that you need to get through to do that. And with that project, we had access to 2,000 scans from cancer patients and doing things like predicting survival times and so on. So the reason that worked is twofold. First of all, the data already existed because it was part of clinical practice. And secondly, we had a hero medical doctor to go to bat for us. My experience as a PhD, not an MD scientist, is that I am a second-class citizen in the health system. So if I go to nurses or doctors or someone and say, I want access to data, they're busy, right? I mean, they've got clinical service they're trying to do. So my request is more time that they don't have. So you really need someone in the medical system who can kind of drive this. And the other thing, I'm most familiar with the Canadian system, which is pretty different from the US system, but there are humongous privacy concerns. So there's all this data. I mean, in Alberta, we have electronic medical records from everybody in the province. So that's 3.5 million people. We have their records, right? We could do something with this in principle, but there are real issues around data access, trying to make sure that nothing gets out in terms of, you know, they don't want people's private medical data being divulged. And it's the usual political thing where, you know, we have been part of ongoing efforts to talk with the politicians, talk with the bureaucrats that run the health system. And inevitably what happens is we make progress and start to get traction, and then the political climate changes. There's an election and things go bleh, and then we start from ground from zero. So we're trying, but it's hard. But I agree.
Combine them jointly.
So the combination of the two.